Forward. Tempting boys to be what they should be, giving them in wholesome form what they want. That is the purpose and power of scouting. To help parents and leaders of youth secure books boys like best that are also best for boys, the Boy Scouts of America organized every boy's library. The books included, formerly sold at prices ranging from $1.50 to $2, but by special arrangement with the several publishers interested, are now sold in every boy's library edition at $1 per volume. The books of every boy's library are selected by the Library Commission of the Boy Scouts of America, consisting of George W. Bowerman, librarian, Public Library of the District of Columbia, Harrison W. Carver, Director, Engineering Society's Library, New York City, Claude G. Leyland, Superintendent, Bureau of Libraries, Board of Education, New York City, Edward F. Stevens, Librarian, Pratt Institute, Free Library, Brooklyn, New York, and Franklin K. Matthews, Chief Scout Librarian. Only such books were chosen by the Commission as proved to be, by a nationwide canvas, most in demand by the boys themselves. Their popularity is further attested by the fact that in every boy's library edition, more than 1.5 million copies of these books have already been sold. We know so well, are reminded so often of the worth of the good book and great, that too often we fail to observe or understand the influence for good of a boy's recreational reading. Such books may influence him for good or ill as profoundly as his play activities, of which they are a vital part. The needful thing is to find stories in which the heroes have the characteristics boys so much admire: unquenchable courage, immense resourcefulness, absolute fidelity, conspicuous greatness. We believe the books of every boy's library measurably well meet this challenge. Boy Scouts of America, James E. West, Chief Scout Executive. Chapter 1. Brother and Sister. They ran across the shining sand, the Pacific thundering its long surge at their backs, and when they gained the roadway, leaped upon bicycles and dived at faster pace into the green avenues of the park. There were three of them, three boys, in as many bright-colored sweaters, and they scorched along the cycle path as dangerously near the speed limit as is the custom of boys in bright-colored sweaters to go. They may have exceeded the speed limit. A mounted park policeman thought so, but was not sure, and contented himself with cautioning them as they flashed by. They acknowledged the warning promptly and, on the next turn of the path, as promptly forgot it, which is also a custom of boys in bright-colored sweaters. Shooting out through the entrance to Golden Gate Park, they turned into San Francisco and took the long sweep of the descending hills at a rate that caused pedestrians to turn and watch them anxiously. Through the city streets, the bright sweaters flew, turning and twisting to escape climbing the steeper hills, and when the steep hills were unavoidable, doing stunts to see which would first gain the top. The boy who most often hit up the pace, led the scorching, and instituted the stunts was called Joe by his companions. It was "follow the leader," and he led, the merriest and boldest in the bunch. But as they pedaled into the Western Addition, among the large and comfortable residences, his laughter became less loud and frequent, and he unconsciously lagged in the rear. At Laguna and Vallejo streets, his companions turned off to the right. "So long, Fred," he called as he turned his wheel to the left. "So long, Charlie." "See you tonight," they called back. "No, I can't come," he answered. "Oh, come on," they begged. "No, I've got to dig. So long." As he went on alone, his face grew grave, and a vague worry came into his eyes. He began resolutely to whistle, but this dwindled away till it was a thin and very subdued little sound, which ceased altogether as he rode up the driveway to a large two-storied house.
"Oh, Joe!"
He hesitated before the door to the library. Bessie was there, he knew, studiously working up her lessons. She must be nearly through with them, too, for she was always done before dinner, and dinner could not be many minutes away. As for his lessons, they were as yet untouched. The thought made him angry. It was bad enough to have one's sister, and 2 years younger at that, in the same grade, but to have her continually head and shoulders above him in scholarship was a most intolerable thing. Not that he was dull. No one knew better than himself that he was not dull. But somehow, he did not quite know how, his mind was on other things, and he was usually unprepared.
"Joe, please come here."
There was the slightest possible plaintive note in her voice this time. "Well," he said, thrusting aside the portiere with an impetuous movement. He said it gruffly, but he was half sorry for it the next instant when he saw a slender little girl regarding him with wistful eyes across a big reading table heaped with books. She was curled up with pencil and pad in an easy chair of such generous dimensions that it made her seem more delicate and fragile than she really was. "What is it, sis?" he asked more gently, crossing over to her side. She took his hand in hers and pressed it against her cheek, and as he stood beside her, came closer to him with a nestling movement.
"What's the matter, Joe, dear?" she asked softly. "Won't you tell me?"
He remained silent. It struck him as ridiculous to confess his troubles to a little sister, even if her reports were higher than his. And the little sister struck him as ridiculous to demand his troubles of him. "What a soft cheek she has," he thought, as she pressed her face gently against his hand. If he could but tear himself away, it was all so foolish. Only he might hurt her feelings, and in his experience, girls' feelings were very easily hurt. She opened his fingers and kissed the palm of his hand. It was like a rose leaf falling. It was also her way of asking her question over again. "Nothing's the matter," he said decisively, and then, quite inconsistently, he blurted out, "Father!" His worry was now in her eyes.
"But Father is so good and kind, Joe," she began. "Why don't you try to please him? He doesn't ask much of you, and it's all for your own good. It's not as though you were a fool like some boys. If you would only study a little bit..."
"That's it, lecturing," he exploded, tearing his hand roughly away. "Even you are beginning to lecture me now. I suppose the cook and the stable boy will be at it next." He shoved his hands into his pockets and looked forward into a melancholy and desolate future filled with interminable lectures and lecturers innumerable. "Was that what you wanted me for?" he demanded, turning to go. She caught at his hand again.
"No, it wasn't. Only you looked so worried that I thought I..."
Her voice broke and she began again freshly.
"What I wanted to tell you was that we're planning a trip across the bay to Oakland next Saturday for a tramp in the hills."
"Who's going?"
"Myrtle Hayes."
"What, that little softy?" he interrupted.
"I don't think she's a softy," Bessie answered with spirit. "She's one of the sweetest girls I know."
"Which isn't saying much, considering the girls you know. But go on, who are the others?"
"Pearl Sather and her sister Alice and Jessie Hilburn and Sadie French and Edna Crothers. That's all the girls."
Joe sniffed disdainfully. "Who are the fellas, then?"
"Morris and Felix Clement, Dick Schofield, Bert Layton, and..."
"That's enough. Milk and water, chaps, all of them."
I wanted to ask you and Fred and Charlie," she said in a quavering voice. "That's what I called you in for, to ask you to come."
"And what are you going to do?" he asked.
"Walk, gather wildflowers. The poppies are all out now. Eat luncheon at some nice place and...
"Come home," he finished for her. Bessie nodded her head. Joe put his hands in his pockets again and walked up and down. "A sissy outfit, that's what it is," he said abruptly, "and a sissy program. None of it in mine, please." She tightened her trembling lips and struggled on bravely.
"What would you rather do?"
she asked. "I'd sooner take Fred and Charlie and go off somewhere and do something, well, anything." He paused and looked at her. She was waiting patiently for him to proceed. He was aware of his inability to express in words what he felt and wanted, and all his trouble and general dissatisfaction rose up and gripped hold of him. "Oh, you can't understand," he burst out. "You can't understand. You're a girl.
You like to be prim and neat, and be good in deportment and ahead in your studies. You don't care for danger and adventure and such things, and you don't care for boys who are rough and have life and go in 'em and all that. You like good little boys with white collars, with clothes always clean and hair always combed, who like to stay in at recess and be petted by the teacher and told how they're always up in their studies. Nice little boys who never get into scrapes, who are too busy walking around and picking flowers and eating lunches with girls to get into scrapes. Oh, I know the kind, afraid of their own shadows, and no more spunk in 'em than in so many sheep. That's what they are, sheep. Well, I'm not a sheep, and there's no more to be said, and I don't want to go on your picnic, and what's more, I'm not going." The tears welled up in Bessie's brown eyes, and her lips were trembling. This angered him unreasonably. What were girls good for, anyway? Always blubbering and interfering and carrying on? There was no sense in them. "A fella can't say anything without making you cry," he began, trying to appease her. "Why, I didn't mean anything, sis. I didn't. Sure, I... He paused helplessly and looked down at her. She was sobbing, and at the same time shaking with the effort to control her sobs, while big tears were rolling down her cheeks. "Oh, you girls," he cried, and strode wrathfully out of the room. Chapter 2. The Draconian Reforms. A few minutes later, and still wrathful, Joe went into dinner. He ate silently, though his father and mother and Bessie kept up a genial flow of conversation. "There she was," he communed savagely with his plate, "crying one minute and the next all smiles and laughter. Now, that wasn't his way. If he had anything sufficiently important to cry about, rest assured he wouldn't get over it for days. Girls were hypocrites. That was all there was to it. They didn't feel 1/100th part of all that they said when they cried. It stood to reason that they didn't. It must be that they just carried on because they enjoyed it. It made them feel good to make other people miserable, especially boys. That was why they were always interfering." Thus reflecting sagely, he kept his eyes on his plate and did justice to the fare, for one cannot scorch from the Cliff House to the Western Addition via the park without being guilty of a healthy appetite. Now and then his father directed a glance at him in a certain mildly anxious way. Joe did not see these glances, but Bessie saw them every one. Mr. Bronson was a middle-aged man, well-developed and heavy-built, though not fat. His was a rugged face, square-jawed and stern-featured, though his eyes were kindly, and there were lines about the mouth that betokened laughter rather than severity. A close examination was not required to discover the resemblance between him and Joe. The same broad forehead and strong jaw characterized them both, and the eyes, taking into consideration the difference of age, were as like as peas from one pod. "How are you getting on, Joe?" Mr. Bronson asked finally. Dinner was over, and they were about to leave the table. "Oh, I don't know," he answered carelessly, and then added, "We have examinations tomorrow. I'll know then." "Whither bound?" his mother questioned, as he turned to leave the room. She was a slender, willowy woman, whose brown eyes Bessie's were, and likewise her tender ways. "To my room," Joe answered. "To work," he supplemented. She rumpled his hair affectionately and bent and kissed him. Mr. Bronson smiled approval at him as he went out, and he hurried up the stairs, resolved to dig hard and pass the examinations of the coming day. Entering his room, he locked the door and sat down at a desk most comfortably arranged for a boy's study. He ran his eye over his textbooks. The history examination came the first thing in the morning, so he would begin on that. He opened the book where a page was turned down and began to read. "Shortly after the Draconian reforms, a war broke out between Athens and Megara respecting the island of Salamis, to which both cities laid claim." Well, that was easy. But what were the Draconian reforms? He must look them up. He felt quite studious as he ran over the back pages, till he chanced to raise his eyes above the top of the book and saw on a chair a baseball mask and a catcher's glove. "They shouldn't have lost that game last Saturday," he thought, "and they wouldn't have either if it hadn't been for Fred." He wished Fred wouldn't fumble so. He could hold 100 difficult balls in succession, but when a critical point came, he'd let go of even a dewdrop. He'd have to send him out in the field and bring in Jones to first base. Only Jones was so excitable. He could hold any kind of a ball, no matter how critical the play was, but there was no telling what he would do with the ball after he got it. Joe came to himself with a start, a pretty way to study history. He buried his head in his book and began. Shortly after the draconian reforms, he read the sentence through three times and then recollected that he had not looked up the draconian reforms. A knock came at the door. He turned the pages over with a noisy flutter, but made no answer. The knock was repeated, and Bessie's, "Joe, dear," came to his ears. "What do you want?" he demanded, but before she could answer, he hurried on. "No admittance, I'm busy."
"I came to see if I could help you," she pleaded. "I'm all done, and I thought..."
"Of course you're all done," he shouted. "You always are." He held his head in both his hands to keep his eyes on the book, but the baseball mask bothered him. The more he attempted to keep his mind on the history, the more in his mind's eye he saw the mask resting on the chair and all the games in which it had played its part. This would never do. He deliberately placed the book face downward on the desk and walked over to the chair. With a swift sweep, he sent both mask and glove hurtling under the bed, and so violently that he heard the mask rebound from the wall. Shortly after the draconian reforms, a war broke out between Athens and Megara. The mask had rolled back from the wall. He wondered if it had rolled back far enough for him to see it. No, he wouldn't look. What did it matter if it had rolled out? That wasn't history. He wondered. He peered over the top of the book, and there was the mask peeping out at him from under the edge of the bed. This was not to be borne. There was no use attempting to study while that mask was around. He went over and fished it out, crossed the room to the closet, and tossed it inside, then locked the door. That was settled, thank goodness. Now he could do some work. He sat down again. Shortly after the draconian reforms, a war broke out between Athens and Megara respecting the island of Salamis, to which both cities laid claim. Which was all very well if he had only found out what the draconian reforms were. A soft glow pervaded the room, and he suddenly became aware of it. What could cause it? He looked out of the window. The setting sun was slanting its long rays against low-hanging masses of summer clouds, turning them to warm scarlet and rosy red, and it was from them that the red light, mellow and glowing, was flung earthward. His gaze dropped from the clouds to the bay beneath. The sea breeze was dying down with the day, and off Fort Point a fishing boat was creeping into port before the last light breeze. A little beyond, a tug was sending up a twisted pillar of smoke as it towed a three-masted schooner to sea. His eyes wandered over toward the Marin County shore. The line where land and water met was already in darkness, and long shadows were creeping up the hills toward Mount Tamalpais, which was sharply silhouetted against the western sky. Oh, if he, Joe Bronson, were only on that fishing boat and sailing in with a deep-sea catch! Or if he were on that schooner, heading out into the sunset, into the world! That was life, that was living, doing something and being something in the world. And instead, here he was, pent up in a close room, racking his brains about people dead and gone thousands of years before he was born. He jerked himself away from the window as though held there by some physical force, and resolutely carried his chair and history into the farthest corner of the room, where he sat down with his back to the window. An instant later, so it seemed to him, he found himself again staring out of the window and dreaming. How he had got there he did not know. His last recollection was the finding of a subheading on a page on the right-hand side of the book, which read, "The Laws and Constitution of Draco." And then, evidently like walking in one's sleep, he had come to the window. How long had he been there, he wondered. The fishing boat which he had seen off Fort Point was now crawling into Meg's wharf. This denoted nearly an hour's lapse of time. The sun had long since set. A solemn grayness was brooding over the water, and the first faint stars were beginning to twinkle over the crest of Mount Tamalpais. He turned with a sigh to go back into his corner when a long whistle, shrill and piercing, came to his ears. That was Fred, he sighed again.
The whistle repeated itself, then another whistle joined it. That was Charlie. They were waiting on the corner. Lucky fellas. Well, they wouldn't see him this night. Both whistles arose in duet. He writhed in his chair and groaned. No, they wouldn't see him this night, he reiterated, at the same time rising to his feet. It was certainly impossible for him to join them when he had not yet learned about the draconian reforms. The same force which had held him to the window now seemed drawing him across the room to the desk. It made him put the history on top of his schoolbooks, and he had the door unlocked and was halfway into the hall before he realized it. He started to return, but the thought came to him that he could go out for a little while and then come back and do his work. A very little while, he promised himself as he went downstairs. He went down faster and faster, till at the bottom he was going 3 steps at a time. He popped his cap on his head and went out of the side entrance in a rush, and ere he reached the corner, the reforms of Draco were as far away in the past as Draco himself, while the examinations on the morrow were equally far away in the future. Chapter 3. Brick, Sorreltop, and Reddy. "What's up?" Joe asked as he joined Fred and Charlie.
"Kites," Charlie answered. "Come on, we're tired out waiting for you."
The three set off down the street to the brow of the hill, where they looked down upon Union Street, far below and almost under their feet. This they called the Pit, and it was well named. Themselves they called the Hill Dwellers, and a descent into the Pit by the Hill Dwellers was looked upon by them as a great adventure. Scientific kite-flying was one of the keenest pleasures of these three particular Hill Dwellers, and 6 or 8 kites strung out on a mile of twine and soaring into the clouds was an ordinary achievement for them. They were compelled to replenish their kite supply often, for whenever an accident occurred and the string broke or a ducking kite dragged down the rest, or the wind suddenly died out, their kites fell into the Pit, from which place they were unrecoverable. The reason for this was that the young people of the Pit were a piratical and robber race with peculiar ideas of ownership and property rights. On a day following an accident to a kite of one of the Hill Dwellers, the selfsame kite could be seen riding the air attached to a string which led down into the Pit to the lairs of the Pit people. So it came about that the Pit people, who were a poor folk and unable to afford scientific kite-flying, developed great proficiency in the art when their neighbors, the Hill Dwellers, took it up. There was also an old sailorman who profited by this recreation of the Hill Dwellers, for he was learned in sails and air currents, and being deft of hand and cunning, he fashioned the best flying kites that could be obtained. He lived in a rattletrap shanty close to the water, where he could still watch with dim eyes the ebb and flow of the tide and the ships pass in and out, and where he could revive old memories of the days when he, too, went down to the sea in ships. To reach his shanty from the hill, one had to pass through the Pit, and thither the three boys were bound. They had often gone for kites in the daytime, but this was their first trip after dark, and they felt it to be, as it indeed was, a hazardous adventure.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.